getting us started. Thank you all for coming. I'm happy to host Alex Gonzalez today for the seminar. And there will be lunch following in the Swanson Room. And then following lunch, there will be a discussion. Alex will be available to discuss whatever you want to discuss with graduate students. Alex has had an interesting career path that has, he's kind of touched on many different components of, I'll say more about this in just a second, but it could be interesting to talk to Alex because he's had experience in several different positions if you're trying to brainstorm different ways to be a scientist. So I first met Alex when I was in graduate school. I went to Colorado State University and my advisor was Wayne Schubert, who is an atmospheric dynamicist. And Alex came as a what's called the SOARS prodigy. SOARS is a program. It's called the Significant Opportunities in Atmospheric Research, Atmospheric Science. Research and Science. That's what SOARS stands for. But SOARS is a great program that has connected a lot of, it sort of helps bring a lot of good minds into the atmospheric research and science field by taking undergraduate students. And then they have a variety of different mentors, research mentors and writing mentors. And they have several summer programs for 10-week intervals where they work on projects. So Alex was an undergraduate at Penn State. And my advisor was his research advisor at Colorado State. So Alex came, and that's how I met Alex. And then Alex ended up coming to Colorado State as a graduate student while I was still there. So we overlapped by a couple of years. So that's how I met Alex. And then after that, he went on. So he was studying the ITCZ at Colorado State, the dynamics of the ITCZ, and we'll learn some about that today. He also was involved in the field project called Dynamo, which was taking a lot of measurements in the Pacific related to VMJO while he was a graduate student. After that, he went to UCLA and JPL for a postdoc. And then after that, he was hired as faculty at Iowa State University, and he was there for a couple of years, right? For
4 years.
4 years.
Yeah.
And now he's a research scientist at Woods Hole. So he's kind of been in several different places, and he's had different kinds of positions at different kinds of institutions. And so I think he'd be an interesting person to talk to just see what it's like in different kinds of institutions after lunch. So with that, I'll let Alex tell us what he's working on now and maybe over the last year or so. And let me know if you want to meet up with Alex. He'll be here tomorrow as well until mid-afternoon. So.
Thank you, Levi. And are we good on Zoom, I assume? I don't have to do anything here?
Yeah, I think so. Okay.
Yeah, you failed to mention, Levi, that we played basketball together.
Oh, yeah.
At CSU. Not for CSU, but
a little bit of light on so we can see him.
Yeah, yeah. I don't want everybody to fall asleep, too. And I promised that I would move around, which is why I'm not using the mic. So am I loud enough? Can people back in the very back hear me? Okay, good. Okay, I've taught big classes and so I'm used to it, but if you can't hear me, please feel free to interrupt me. So yeah, we played basketball together. Our team was really bad, but it was fun at the time. It was good exercise, right? So I've kind of taken an interesting career path. I work at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, and they used to have a really strong marine meteorology presence there back in the days when Joanne Simpson was there. And so that was back in the early 90s, I think, or no, that was probably even earlier than that. But things fell off, I think, in the early 90s. So there aren't that many meteorologists there. They've started to come back up with more sort of a climate science group. So recently they're trying to hire more people in the climate area, which means you need atmospheric scientists and you need also ocean scientists. So it fits nicely with this department, which has both of those focuses. So yeah, so my talk is on the ITCZ, the Inter-Tropical Convergence Zone, and talking about connections between low clouds as well as the equatorial cold tongue. And if you're not familiar with these things, we will talk about them in this talk. So the first thing I want to do that I've been trying to remember to do is to acknowledge the land on which I conducted this work, which at HUI was the ancestral land of the Wampanoag peoples. They're actually they were the ones who in Massachusetts that were Thanksgiving, they originated with settlers and the indigenous people that came together for Thanksgiving, they were the Wampanoag, and they're still there. So, and I live actually in the town of Mashpee, and so that's also another tribe. So, yeah, just want to acknowledge that land. And if you ever want to give one of these talks or see more details about where Native people lived or still do live, you can look at this website here, nativeland.ca. I also want to acknowledge my funding, which is NSF, two different grants, and really grateful for being able to have their support on this work. So I start off, and I also have my timer on, which will probably go off at some point, but I just want to stay within the time. I want a good introduction here so that people can kind of get a sense. My goal is for people to come out of the talk with maybe me covering less, but in them understanding better than me bulldozing everybody. So we start off with this precipitation map. This is annual precipitation from the Global Precipitation Climatology Project. And it spans, I think, 1979 to 2014. And it's from Adam et al. 2016. You can see, you know, I'm gonna actually use this. Okay, so it is working okay now. So you can see that precipitation in the tropics dominates. You can see the storm tracks. So these convergence zones or these precipitation zones, the winds often come together, and this is where your ITCZ is. And you can see that the Eastern Pacific region, can I get rid of this? I forget, can I just do this? Nope. Down here, okay. The East Pacific really, it rarely has precipitation in the Southern Hemisphere. And so on an annual average, you can see, and this has a laser too, although I kind of want it to be on the recording. I don't know. Can it see me here when I'm pointing?
Do you know? No. Okay.
So basically we have the precipitation zone here, to the north here in the Atlantic and the East Pacific. And we'll see there's a preference for that. As we go in other regions, you may even have in the annual average Southern Hemisphere dominated precip. And this is particularly over the ocean regions. So there's this like longstanding question, why is that the case? Why do these regions only have precipitation or have dominant precipitation in one hemisphere? Why isn't it on the equator? Like we learned about probably in our first climate class that talks about the Hadley circulation, all the schematics are like centered on the equator. This is where the precipitation happens in the tropics. That's not really the case in reality. So this is something that has been an interest of mine and many people for, you know, decades. And so the East Pacific and the Atlantic tend to have more of the northern-based ITCZs. If you take an average in the east-west direction over the whole globe, over land, you actually get precipitation on the equator on average over the whole entire year for all 40 years of data. Over the ocean, it's biased to the north. And that's because of the East Pacific and the Atlantic. They span, you know, long longitude. So even if you have in this region, which is focused on Southern Hemisphere dominated precipitation in the Indian Ocean, still these regions dominate. So there are regional reasons why. Obviously there's different regions that have different behavior, but a more general idea that has come about in the climate modeling community is, and this has actually come up even more, this says 1995, but it's come up even more recently, more land in the Northern Hemisphere heats up faster. And this idea of the energy imbalance, because of that, there's an energy imbalance towards the Northern Hemisphere. And so the energy needs to be exported to the Southern Hemisphere. And so this idea has been posed for a long time. Continental geometry, people have talked about the fact that there's ocean to the south here, south of the East Pacific ITCZ. And then also similarly, Africa is to the north where you have a Northern ITCZ here. But then in this region, it's slightly different. You have land to the north, but it's totally confined, whereas over here the ocean is a lot more freer to move. So this talks about, these ideas talk about energy imbalance and some other ideas that I'm not going to get into, but we want to focus today on the East Pacific and answer the question, or at least think about, well, why is the precipitation to the north all the time? Is it related to clouds in particular, or is there an additional effect from, I guess the question is, the clouds in the intertropical convergence zone, are they the only thing that's important, or are there other clouds or other phenomena that might be important to this? And I'm asking that question because I'll show evidence for that. If we take an average over that region that I just pointed out in the box, we take an average in the east-west direction, and we just look at precip. And this is using the NASA IMERGE precipitation data set, which is the newest data set. You would get it with any of the data sets. This is basically a monthly climatology over all the years of data. You can see latitude on the y-axis, and then each month of the year on the x-axis. You can see mostly northern hemisphere precip, but there is actually, there are a few months when there's southern hemisphere precip. And this is often called the double ITCZ. This happens around March, the months surrounding March. So this is interesting because climate model biases tend to be largest during these months when you do have precipitation in the southern hemisphere. The problem with them here is, and I'll click one more time, these coupled model intercomparison projects. So basically there's, you know, at this point, there's probably about 30 plus models that participate in this. And there have been different iterations of this. Pretty much every decade, there's a new one. And so the last three, CMIP 3, 5, and 6, the precipitation in March is shown here, the bias. So you can see the blues show too much precipitation to the south and not enough to the north. And you get this bias towards the southern hemisphere, and it peaks in March, which is a very similar timing as to when we get actually precipitation in the southern hemisphere in observations, but it's just too much in models. So there's this bias, and really we call it the double ITCZ bias because if I go back, we see that during this time of the year in observations, there is a double ITCZ, but it's the ITCZ to the south is weaker. So if you have a bias that's positive in the south, then you're getting more symmetric conditions. Sorry, I thought about putting another figure with the actual total precip, but we want to understand this asymmetry and keep this in mind because a similar picture will show up in some of our simulations. Yeah. So and another thing is there's been no improvement over the past 30 years among these different experiments. And there are multiple papers that have basically said the model spread has gone down. So what that means is the models are you've got probably models that are much better at diagnosing the precipitation or predicting the precipitation. And then you have models that are in the other direction. They have too much or they have too little. And then that offset, you know, that variance has a mean. So the mean hasn't changed, but the variance has gone down. So there's a little bit more model agreement, but still agreement and there's still errors. The errors are really, really similar. So this is using all the models. This paper actually does look at like the top models versus the bottom models, which is an interesting and nice experiment, or at least thing to look at. Not looking at all the models, but looking at ones that do well and ones that don't. So these biases are, I would say, are tied to our lack of understanding and obviously simulation of ITCZ physics. But in this talk, I'm going to focus a lot on physical understanding. I'm going to use simple models. So I'd like to talk about our lack of understanding. Especially over the ocean where these biases are largest and where we still haven't answered the question in the community of why in nature do we have this preference to the northern hemisphere in these regions. We have there's a lot of evidence as to why. I mean, we're probably never going to be able to come up with this is why. But I think in general, we do have some ideas. So the models tend to have actually SST gradients in the north-south direction and even in east-west, but particularly the north-south direction, biased towards the southern hemisphere. So what that means is, remember we had precipitation bias towards the southern hemisphere, in the southern hemisphere too much. So basically the SSTs warm up too much in the southern hemisphere and not enough in the northern hemisphere. So you get this wind evaporation SST feedback. So you can kind of flip this around. In this paper, I think to the north was where it's warm and to the south is where it's cold, but you can flip it around and basically the bias is towards the south. So you'd have warm SSTs to the south. So I basically can say up here is the south. Warm SSTs to the south, cool SSTs to the north. And eventually you end up getting an enhancement of that gradient over time that just builds up and into these feedbacks that can make your model have sea surface temperatures that are 3 or 4 Kelvin too large in the southern hemisphere. I'll show a plot actually of what that looks like in a second. So that's, you know, that's talking about air-sea coupling and climate models obviously have issues with that in many other areas other than the tropics. There's also the misrepresentation of tropical convection, which has to do with the atmosphere-only component, at least the first order. And that has to do with, it's pretty widely known their insensitivity to lower free tropospheric humidity. So we all know that, or maybe we don't all know, but we all know a good idea is that near the surface, the boundary layer is quite moist over the ocean. And so typically what is an inherent process that can be detrimental to convection is that the humidity above the boundary layer is too dry. So, or the model is too insensitive to that. So the model might want to produce too much precipitation in the southern hemisphere because it's not sensitive enough to this lower free tropospheric humidity. So if we look at this plot right here, it shows us specific humidity as a function of height using different field campaign data. And really the big thing that comes out here is this variance plot. So this is a mean, which when you look at all the plots on top of each other, it's kind of hard to tell. But when you look at the variance in the humidity as a function of height for these different regions and also different, actually they're different seasons and two different data sets, you see the variance is quite high in the boundary layer and just above that. So starting around 900 hectopascals. So this really convection is sensitive to the variability in free tropospheric humidity. This is well known for the tropics and deep convection. Whoops, I don't know what just happened. Went all the way to the end. I'm gonna exit and go back to the beginning, sorry. Don't press zero. That's what happened, I pressed zero. Probably that goes to the end. Okay, another thing that we have to be cognizant of in climate models that have sort of, it's sort of been a tangential, how do we get rid of the top? Didn't I just do this? Okay. Usually it just disappears over a certain amount of time. So I'm just gonna not touch it. And hopefully it goes right.
Can you drag it down?
Yeah. Okay, got it. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, so low clouds, which I'm just going to do a little background. Low clouds are pretty important in this region as well. So in this plot right here, I show subtropical stratocumulus over the East Pacific. You can look at, I mean, these days with how good our satellite products are, you can look at this any day of the year. And these are really persistent clouds. They actually tend to peak in the early morning hours, so you wouldn't actually always see them as prevalent during the daytime when you have visible. But visible satellite imagery, like when they show up, they're pretty clear. They can be quite broken. And they could be quite widespread here, especially near the coast of South America. We're in the southern hemisphere here. Up here is actually closer to the equator, so the equator is somewhat up here. And so these actually extend all the way into the tropics. I mean, we talk about them as subtropical, but they can extend pretty far, in this case, north. And now it's not. Okay. And if you look at a climatology of where they occur, we can see that they tend to occur in these regions off the eastern ocean basins, off the coast, the west coast of the continent. So you can see them in California, if you've ever been to San Francisco in the fall, or even the summertime, they tend to be quite prevalent. And so that's why you don't get pretty, I mean, you can get in summertime a high of 60 and quite cloudy because of these stratocumulus decks and off the coast of South America. But like I said, the ones off the coast of South America get pretty close to the equator. And they do also in the Atlantic, off the coast of Africa. You can kind of see it down here too in the Indian Ocean, but they don't spread as close to the equator. So these regions actually have these stratocumulus and they're quite prevalent. Now these clouds don't, I'll actually go back. These clouds don't precipitate very much. I mean, they can drizzle, but they're not really convective in the sense that they're not gonna produce high rainfall rates. But they're important from the perspective of blocking solar insulate solar radiation from hitting the surface when you have these decks that have a an albedo that is going to reflect the sunlight and sort of keep the sea surface temperatures quite cool, even all the way up to the equator. So if we need to represent these in climate models better for this problem, which I still haven't made the connection yet, we need to understand this atmosphere-ocean coupling, like I said, because we're talking now about the sea surface temperature and how radiation is not hitting the sea surface and warming up the sea surface. But there's also an idea, once you get these low clouds, they blanket the surface, So you may have cool SSTs when they first form, and then you block the solar insulation, so you further cool down the SSTs, and now you have this positive feedback. The low clouds tend to form in cool regions, regions of cool SSTs, and then they tend to block solar radiation. So you kind of have this positive feedback. So atmosphere-ocean coupling is still important, as well as these clouds happen over a really thin layer, which is my next plot. Actually, it doesn't have scale, but these typically are on the order of 50 meters to 100 meters thick. So in a climate model, that might be in the vertical resolution one data point, maybe two, if you're just depends. And the analysis too, I mean, it's suspect as to whether they can resolve these really thin clouds that have really strong inversions. So the temperature tends to increase with height here. And so you kind of have, and this doesn't show this, but you have the free troposphere above, and you actually have warm subsiding air. And then you have this cooler, moister air below that actually mixes turbulently because the winds are quite strong below. So you get strong latent heat fluxes and surface fluxes that help drive these clouds. And so these are all processes that are important to the clouds. And in particular, we tend to get the strong long wave cooling, which we'll come back to. So we know it tends to be cool below here, and that makes sense because of the fact that these clouds are blocking the sun from coming in, but they also tend to do that shielding. And then we get this long wave cooling response, and that's gonna be an important factor we're gonna keep in mind. Second point here was in a westward extension of the cold tongue. So what this is showing here is the last iteration before this most recent one of CMIP that shows the SST bias annually averaged this time. And you can see it's too cold along the equator. And this is the cold tongue bias. It extends way too far west. So it's kind of a little bit farther outside of our region, but it's also something that we need to consider as another player in this story, because it's on the equator, it produces this cold bias. If you can think about it in this way, if there's a cold bias here and there's a warm bias here, again, you're directing the air towards the southern hemisphere, right? You have low pressure where there's warm sea surface temperatures, and now you're again directing the air towards the southern hemisphere and actually towards the northern here, so you get a double ITCZ bias. So these are the biases, and then when you kind of take the difference between the most recent and last iteration of CMIP, you tend to see the cold tongue bias in sort of a more fuller extent. You can see how it extends further west. Okay, so we've got all these things going on. We have low clouds, we have ITCZ, and we have the cold tongue. I kind of have said they're related, but maybe I haven't shown good evidence yet, but I will show that even more when we do some simulations here. And we're going to opt for some physical understanding here. We're not going to run a full-fledged climate model. We're going to run something idealized where we can somewhat isolate the effects of low clouds and also the cold tongue on the ITCZ. So we're going to do this using an idealized model. There's been a lot of studies that have shown this idea that I kind of have talked or danced around, which is that the low-level convergence in the ITCZ is driven by SST gradients, right? I've said, if it's warm SSTs, you tend to have low pressure. If it's cool SSTs, high pressure. And so when it's too warm in the southern hemisphere, you get convergence. So this has been shown in a number of papers. This bottom plot is surface convergence in an observational data set, the ECMWF's ERA 40. And you can see here in the red, it's convergence in the ITCZ and divergence on the equator associated with the cold tongue. And there's somewhat of a secondary ITCZ in the southern hemisphere, and that's actually, it is realistic using observational data. This is a reanalysis, so it's not 100% observations. This is a really simple model that I'm sort of gonna show a similar version of it. So the really simple model, idealized model, you can see there are some biases towards the southern hemisphere. And the northern hemisphere is not so bad, but we have these sort of cold tongue divergence and then too much convergence in the southern hemisphere. And this version of the model actually uses not just SSTs, but it looks at the boundary layer temperature. But when you look at the SSTs only, which is the bottom plot, you can start to see how the first MLM and the second one, with just SST only, the biases get worse, in particular near the equator and south of the equator. And this, when I've seen this, I've just always thought, hey, there's gotta be, oh, I guess the colors are showing up weird. Sorry, it looks different on my screen. Still interpretable, but—
I think the contrast is clear.
If I overlay, I always have thought, okay, well, there's a cold tongue that's got to have an influence on this, right? Because this is SST driven only, and you get this strong cold water right here that can often be as low as 20 Celsius in summertime on the equator. And so I've always thought, you know, there's got to be something related to the cold tongue or low clouds. And so if you overlay stratocumulus cloud cover over it, you can see, okay, the low clouds are maximizing here. That's actually a little south of where you're getting the convergence. But I've always thought, hey, there's got to be some sort of influence there. There are actually relative max and low clouds here, and actually a dearth of low clouds here, but still low clouds. So I just thought there's got to be something related to low clouds here. And it's happening in both hemispheres, or in both basins. So too much southern hemisphere convergence in the SST only. And that's where, again, you have the low clouds. Okay. So how we're going to sort of think about this is we're going to look at how the pressure gradient force on the surface can be driven by boundary layer temperature gradients through hydrostaticity. So hopefully I don't scare you too much with equations, but if we just look at the horizontal momentum equations, you know, one of the main factors is a surface pressure gradient force. If you do a surface budget, you know, you have your acceleration of the winds, horizontal winds, and you have a pressure gradient force. You have Coriolis, you have many terms. We're going to focus on the pressure gradient because we keep talking about SSTs and how they influence the pressure. And so this is the pressure gradient is going to be what we're centered around here. So what we do here actually is we take hydrostatic balance and we apply, we're going to see the horizontal gradient applied to it. So this is hydrostatic balance and pressure coordinates. And then we just apply the horizontal gradient to it. In this case, we're going to focus on north-south gradient, but you just apply the gradient to both sides and you get a temperature gradient on this side. The last thing we need here is to isolate the geopotential at the surface, and we have a pressure derivative, so we've got to vertically integrate. So we integrate in this case, and this is the decision, from the surface to the pretroposphere, the bottom. So 850 hectopascals. This is because I have an a priori knowledge that pretropospheric pressure gradients in the tropics are small. So especially on the time scales I'm going to look at here, which is just monthly evolution. I'm not looking at an individual event. I'm looking at like 40 years of data and looking month to month. So we're going to do that integral. And when we do that integral on the left-hand side, you basically get your geopotential gradient at the surface, and then you get an integral over the boundary layer of the virtual temperature. And then you get, because remember when you do this integral, you have a surface term and you have a free tropospheric term. So you also get this term right here, which is, I'll go in order, surface pressure gradient force. This is the surface and boundary layer virtual temperature gradient, horizontal virtual temperature gradient, and then our free tropospheric pressure field, which we know based on past observations and looking at the data that 850 hectopascals is this level, and there's the pressure gradients are small. Okay, so some research questions. Are there significant differences in SST versus upper boundary layer virtual temperature gradients? Because past studies have said SSTs are the main drivers, but I've always thought, well, there's got to be something else that, you know, we can learn from looking at a more complete, because obviously, if I go back to this, within this integral, there's the surface part and then there's the boundary layer part, everything above the surface that needs to be integrated. If you just do the surface, you are missing information about what's happening in the boundary layer. And that may not be the same as the SST in terms of its gradients. So my second question is, do the differences in SST versus upper boundary layer virtual temperature gradients lead to significant differences in low-level convergence in the ITCZ? And then is there a seasonality to these differences? The reason why I ask seasonality, because that might point to, in this case, is we'll see where low clouds might play a role, because we know they're strongest during the fall, summer to fall, and the cold tongue as well. So if there's a seasonality, then I can sort of point to that as, okay, this is where I want to focus my interpretation, the rest of my analysis. Then the last thing is, what are the roles of the trade wind inversion? Trade wind inversion has to do with temperature field, so that's can be connected to this. Low clouds are more indirectly connected, but they're there as well. And the equatorial cold tongue, which is again related to the SST in this case, enforcing this ITCZ convergence, especially in the southern hemisphere where we have these biases in models. So I'm going to use a reanalysis data set, which if you're not familiar, involves observations and then a model that fills in any observational gaps, or if there's multiple observations at one point, is able to concisely put that into one gridded data set. And we're looking at the monthly climatological fields for from 1979 to 2021. So we look at 1 month at a time. We just do January, February for all 42 years of data. And then we look at low cloud fractions, for particularly for stratocumulus clouds from two data sets in this Cascade data set. And this data set has multiple different types of clouds. This is stratocumulus on its own, but it has different, you know, different types of scenarios. Like I showed you, they can break up and you can have sun getting in between these clouds. Those are broken SC. A lot of different types you can look at. It's a great data set. But we're going to focus most of our attention on SC. So we will use an idealized model. And this is a boundary layer model. It's a slab model. So it has no vertical information. Everything is assumed to be well mixed. And so we have this atmospheric boundary layer model. And we take it and we actually prescribe. We prescribe the boundary layer height from ERA 5 reanalysis. And then we force it by the surface pressure gradient force that we did the derivation on. And that's just going to be what changes in all the simulations is a surface pressure gradient force. And then we also have free tropospheric velocity fields, again, prescribed from ERA 5. Those won't change simulation to simulation. The only thing that's going to change is a surface pressure gradient. We have the monthly output. For this presentation, I'll focus mostly on September and March. And we have two experiments. And the experiments basically have just a different form of the surface pressure gradient force. We have the full virtual temperature gradient experiment, and then we have SST-only experiment. The SST-only basically, it does have a boundary layer, really. And basically, it just says the SST information, the gradients in the SSTs are going to be felt throughout the boundary layer, and they'll just decay with height. And that is the assumption that's been used in many of these other studies. So if we take a look at the form of the full experiment, it's just exactly like the real observed case. You can use the integral, and you can calculate it numerically and compare with ERA 5 and figure out, do I get the right geopotential field, and it's very accurate. So we have that, which we're going to also call the observed. SST only basically does this integral, assuming that structure. So A here, you can see the gradient in here. We already did the integral. And the integral here is I already assume a vertical structure for the SST gradients. And that is that they decay with height, and they end up decaying by 75%. And that's what that 0.75 is. So for example, at the top of the free troposphere, at the top of the integral, this is one. So you're only left with one minus 0.75, you get 25%. So basically SST gradient just decays with height. So that's all this is saying here. And so we just use the SST information, that's it. Whereas obviously with this, we use the whole entire ERA 5 field. So my first question, let's try to answer that. Are there significant differences in SST versus upper boundary layer virtual temperature gradients? This is before running the model. So again, my observed temperature gradients, we're going to just look at the virtual temperature gradient as a function of latitude and pressure. And I didn't mention this before, but we just average the fields in the east-west direction for just the East Pacific, kind of like we've been doing in the past with the box I showed. We're going to compare that with the SST gradients, SST-only virtual temperature gradients. So the SST field multiplied by this linear decrease of SST gradient with height. Okay, so first starting off with two plots, I kind of want to be up here. Yeah, the color is very different on my screen, but still looks okay. So there's two sides. Here's the actual DTVDY, so the north-south gradient. This is latitude, this is pressure, and this is the boundary layer top that we're using for our integrals in the model that we haven't showed yet. And this is sort of the observed temperature field, but it's sort of an anomaly because I can add the background temperature, but then you'd lose all the information about the vertical structure. So I'm basically removing, it's kind of like removing a background temperature field. So what you see here is you see that there's a northward temperature gradient that's quite strong in the boundary layer, and that's just south of where the ITCZ is observed. And we have this southward gradient. So we have this kind of divergence near the equator, but it's quite shallow. And then we have this northward gradient here, which extends down to the surface, but is strongest actually just above the top of the boundary layer. And so this extends into the northern hemisphere, and believe that this is important for understanding why the ITCZ is strongest in the north and not necessarily as strong in the south. So we get if we did the TV anomaly, if you just want to think about the tetra field, we have the cold tongue here as a relative cold area, but we also have this cold air up here that extends to the surface. And so these two regions are going to be really important, because the one near the equator is related to the cold tongue, equatorial cold tongue, and this is related to the interaction between low clouds and the sea surface, as well as long wave cooling the full clouds. If we look at this, so I said, yeah, it dominates. Northward TV gradients dominate. Note that this is just for September, but this is for almost all the months. And I'll show you that in a little bit. If you look at SST only, we can see there's no change in the gradients with height. They just decay. Like we said, we still have this northward gradient. It is strong. It's actually stronger, but that southward gradient is too strong and obviously extends too far south. And we don't get anything up here that's strong enough, as we see in observations, that's deep. And so the SST-only anomaly has this cold tongue signature that's a similar magnitude as to what's going on in this low cloud region. So basically, we kind of have this mismatch between the observations. And this SST-only sort of scenario, hypothetical scenario of SST-only dominating. So what we get when we take this minus this, in a more general sense, is it's too warm to the south, too cool to the north, which, remember, we talked about there being a southern hemisphere bias in the models. This is kind of a general statement. You know, there's too much, the SST only is gonna have actually too much convergence in this region, even though it shows up, it doesn't show up as red, as warm. In a dynamical way, there is gonna be convergence in this region, because we're gonna get relative low pressure here, relative high pressure here, and relative low pressure. So it's too warm to the south, too cool to the north. So if we take a look at this in the observations, we're just going to point out two areas of interest. We have the ITCZ region where it's warm. That seems to be relatively in common between the two, SST only versus the other one. But it's the surface cold tongue anomaly and then the elevated cold anomaly up here, which I think is related to the trade wind inversion, but I haven't shown evidence for that. But we'll keep that in mind. Okay. So we answered our question. SST only TV gradients are too symmetric about the equator. They lack this deep elevated cold air in the southern hemisphere that could be related to low clouds and the trade wind inversion. Okay, so our next question is the differences in, I gotta be careful with my time here. Sorry. Okay. The differences in these temperature gradients lead to significant differences in low level convergence in the ITCZ, because we gotta show the connection to the ITCZ. We're just showing temperature field. And then is there a seasonality to this? So actually, I'm going to skip some of these slides because I was going to show the surface pressure gradient. I'll just show the first one. This is, you can even ignore the text. Just listen to me. So basically, we've got geopotential fields. And I've, again, put it as an anomaly because it's just easier to visualize as a function of latitude. And we can see, I got rid of my legend. So the blue is SST only, the black is the observed field. And we get this basically from, we had the temperature gradients, right? But remember we had these integral formula. That's basically what this is. This is basically your pressure field. So you can see there are differences near the equator, where the blue line is actually anomalously high pressure, right? Because it's more positive. And then up here, it's anomalously low. Also anomalously high up here and anomalously low. So in a general sense, like we said, too warm to the south is going to create low pressure to the south, and then this high pressure in the equator, and then also high pressure to the north. So too much southern hemisphere convergence, too much low pressure in the southern hemisphere, and too much high pressure near the equator and in the northern hemisphere. So it kind of comes back to this idea. I'm going to skip this. So let's look at the simulations. So the full TV experiment is going to be like as close to the observations as we can get. Right, this is going to be our observed. And then the SST-only experiment, which is going to be some hypothetical situation where SSTs dominate. So full TV as a function of latitude and month of the year. So now our model, like I said, didn't have east-west variation. It just has north-south variation. It's a mixed model, boundary layer, slab model. So there's no vertical information. So what we have here is a convergence of the boundary layer. Blue is convergence and red is divergence at the surface. we can see as a function of the time of the year, like most of the year, especially May through December, there's divergence near the equator associated with the cold tongue, and then convergence in the ITCZ. And then the southern hemisphere, although not easy to see here, it's actually weak convergence. And this is actually well known that there's actually weak convergence in the southern hemisphere in this region, but often it doesn't lead to an ITCZ. It's just not strong enough. But we do get, remember that observed double ITCZ in the spring? It happens. And so this is well constrained by observations, or this is an agreement. If you look at SST only, you tend to get way too much divergence on the equator, and now you have a double ITCZ. And this persists, of course, during this time of the year, it's closer to the observations because there's more of a double ITCZ in the observations. But May through December, there shouldn't be a secondary ITCZ. It's not as strong as the northern, but it's getting close to that. And that's just not reasonable based on observations. So here's our comparison. I had a plot that actually took the differences, but I think it's clear to see. Easy to see. Too much divergence on the equator. Too much off-equatorial convergence, particularly in the southern hemisphere. As a matter of fact, the northern hemisphere convergence is a little too weak. And we had said that there's going to be an anomalous high up here, but it's in general okay. In the northern hemisphere, it's a little too close to the equator, so it's more bound to the equator, whereas this, an observation than in this model, the ITCZ goes as far as 10 north. And during this time of the year is when you get tropical cyclones, like the one that just, and often they come off the ITCZ because the ITCZ forms as a linear band and it becomes unstable. And then you get MCSs, convective systems that can build into tropical cyclones in the East Pacific. So this is an agreement with our observations. So to answer our second question, do these gradients lead to significant differences in the ITCZ in our simulations? And is there a seasonality? Yes. Yeah, very big differences. SST gradients tend to overdo equatorial divergence in a double ITCZ, especially during May through December. I got to stop overusing the laser pointer. And then my last question was the role of trade wind inversion in low clouds. What else can we do to explain this? Okay, I'm going to give myself 4 more minutes to wrap up here. Okay, so this was our idea, right? Let's come back to this plot. ITCZ to the north, cold tongue anomaly or cold tongue signature to near the equator. And to the south, we have this elevated cold anomaly. First, we're going to look at 7.5 south. We're going to look at the vertical structure of the temperature field. And then we'll look at the equator. So the very first plot is 7.5 south over the East Pacific. This is the virtual temperature derived lapse rate. So positive values mean the temperature is decreasing with pressure. So decreasing with decreasing pressure, so it's positive. So that's what we're getting down here, and actually getting close to values close to dry adiabatic, and then you get to moist adiabatic, so your clouds form somewhere in here, and above those clouds, you get an inversion at 7.5 south. At the equator, and that's for September, March, you can see how it relaxes, because remember March, you can get an ITCZ, so you can see how the lapse rates change significantly, very drastically from September to March. Near the equator, you still have a very weak inversion. And this is error 5. You could do this with MERA and some other reanalyses. MERA is pretty good, but not all of them are good with representing this. So they can get this thin inversion. That's about 100 meters thick. In this case, it's one grid point at the equator. So weak. And you can see the seasonal change in that. Now, what we see here is the temperature field, again, written as an anomaly. So we get rid of the background temperature decreasing with height, so we can see the differences. We see the elevated cold anomaly in the black, which is 7.5 south. So the black is 7.5 south. We see the elevated cold anomaly and actually warm air above. And then the blue line is the equatorial, where you can see the cold tongue is stronger, that signature in the atmosphere. So the coldest air is near the surface. So we see that mismatch. And if we take for the black minus the blue here, we see that I'm messing this up. Yes, okay. I think this might be wrong. So basically, yes. Yeah, so going from 7.5 south to the equator, at 7.5 south, it's cooler up here, right? We have the elevated cool anomaly, so that's why we get the gradient is negative, and then it reverses and it's positive near the surface. So that's kind of an extra detail. But we see this idea that we've seen with the elevated cold anomaly and the trade wind inversion, that they're connected. last thing is we want to look at these plots, and we kind of had the question of, okay, is this cloud top cooling, that elevated cold anomaly? It's cold throughout the column. That's why there are negative values in the black. But it's particularly cold where, you know, basically these low clouds, like we said, are from 900 to 950. Even based on the lapse rate, you can kind of interpret it's going to moist adiabatic. And so you've got cloud coverage here, but let's confirm it with some cloud data. The stratocumulus cloud data as a function of month of the year over the East Pacific, and here at 7.5 south in the blue and the equator in the black as a function of height. And we can see the height of this cloud top cooling is associated, or is very, very much similar to what we see in the low cloud 7.5 south region. It's happening near about a kilometer or a kilometer and a half. And then we see near the equator, you have in the black line, the maximum amount of stratocumulus cloud cover happening at a lower height. And that would explain why we got, remember, the trade wind inversion as it's at a lower height near the equator. So we see a lot of these same things. And again, the peak in September, you know, March, you tend to have very little or a lot less low cloud coverage. So these are all in agreement, peak in September, minimum in March. And there are two data sets here. I only showed one, but they have very good agreement. So to answer my last question, what are the roles? And in many ways, it's kind of, you know, I can only diagnose this with this model. I don't have low clouds forming, but we get this idea of this cold anomaly related to the trade wind inversion. And then the equatorial cold tongue is quite shallow. So the cold tongue boundary layer influence is weak and shallow. It promotes a double ITCZ. The trade wind inversion boundary layer influence is deep and strong, and it promotes more of a northern ITCZ. So this is our conceptual figure at the end, where we have the ITCZ to the north, and to the south, we have low clouds and the cold tongue. They both have an influence on what we see in nature. Cold tongue is not that strong. It's not that deep. It produces, even though I only have one ITCZ, it produces that weak southern hemisphere convergence that we see all year in observations, but the low clouds are a stronger factor, or at least play a bigger role, and they're quite deep and extensive vertically, not the clouds themselves, but the temperature effect. And so basically we've kind of come up with, and I'm actually gonna skip some of these and just go to this. And I kind of said this, our main takeaway is the equatorial cold tongue favors equatorial divergence and off equatorial convergence, a double ITCZ. And this boundary layer signature of it is quite shallow and weak. And so this connects to observations we have that near the cold tongue, you get cold SSTs. There's a limit basically to how much flux you can get. If your SSTs are too cool, the temperature in the air ends up being the same as the sea surface, and you get no flux, you get no sensible heat flux. And so, and over this region, we tend to see lower wind speeds. So you don't really get much latent heat flux either. So this explains why we see this in observations. It's quite shallow, it's quite weak. So its effect is quite small. Whereas the trade wind inversion tends to be horizontally extensive, and the temperature field is deep and strong, and it can extend far in latitude and affect the ITCZ and sort of shielding the southern hemisphere. Okay, so we've sort of shown this dynamical link through this model of these three phenomena, and they're all problematic in climate models. So it's something that we still need to learn more about some of the mechanisms, but this is the overall goal. My last thing I wanted to say, is I do more than just this research. I'm really excited and want to show a little bit about some of the teaching mentoring that I've done with this DIY Dynamics team called the Do-It-Yourself Dynamics team. So we, maybe I should show the actual the tank experiments we do that are these Lego-based tank experiments. We've been doing these teaching workshops using different types of tanks with Lego motors. And basically we teach teachers how to do this on the university level, K through 12 level, to learn basic climate science, ocean and atmosphere concepts. And we use things like Earth Knowles School, Wendy.com, and other online resources that are free to sort of promote climate science education. And so this is the group of us from 2 years ago. And so it's been really a pleasure to work on that. So if you're interested in more, you can talk to me or Google it, DIY Dynamics. And we're just looking for people. It's sort of an open community for people to come in and contribute. So it's not just me, it's a group of, now we've got 50 plus people contributing. So I'm really excited about it. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Alex. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, so this is very interesting. Have you tried to look at the like the GCM output to see whether the temperature has a bias south of the equator?
That's the next step, to take the methodology here, and you could easily apply it to any data set and see, you know, of course you can diagnose it at the end of the run, but it would be nice to do it in a time-dependent way, or at least see seasonally too, like, you know, how fast the low clouds recede in September leading up to March. Like, that's my first goal, is to try to see how it evolves monthly and to see sort of how these details affect the temperature field, which ends up affecting the convergence. So it's a nice sort of diagnostic for that. And I think that's kind of what we promote in the paper, is that this can be extended, so it'll be looked at. And the SST only, you know, sort of idea is still a first start to like run a simple model, but it's also a cautionary reminder. You should just do the full integral basically. And you should be aware that the low cloud signature can be interpreted. Because in the past papers that I've written about this, they've said maybe, you know, low clouds could have an influence, but we don't know like what that is. And so I think this is a way to potentially understand a little bit more about those interactions, along with like understanding the fluxes, which I touched on, but those are important too. Basically, you know, that interaction between the low clouds and the SST is really important, and it's hard to disentangle, because once you get the low clouds, they block the insulation, and then you get this feedback. So I think that this is a diagnostic and can be helpful.
Yeah, very interesting talk. So you kind of suggest that it's the bias of the temperature structure in the southern hemisphere, the cold part, that is important. So if you just compare the two temperature structure that you showed, there is some bias in the northern hemisphere also. It seems
yes.
That the SST only entries decays much faster than the observed. So
yes.
Does that actually play any role? Have you done experiment with just removing the cold bias and see whether the warm bias in the southern hemisphere?
Yeah, there's even more to like. I mean, the northern hemisphere, the SST only will confine everything close to the equator. I think it has to do with that cold tongue. You know, basically the idea is if you keep the SST gradient the same, the cold tongue extends through the boundary layer and it just has too strong of an effect. So you just get such strong divergence, at least in this model, that kind of, that idea keeps the ITCZ, it makes it a double, but it also confines it. Because what you really want in observations is there is southerly flow that flows all the way into the ITCZ, but it slows down at points. And those details about where it slows down are get overridden by the cold tongue if you just do SST only. And so some of those ideas in the northern hemisphere are important because we saw not enough precipitation in the north in models. And that's often a bias that we see. Not enough to the north, too much to the south. So it's more even in both hemispheres. And that's why you get the double. Another thing is, we talked about the low clouds. The cold tongue bias too is something that people talk about, both related to the ITCZ. And so this is kind of a way to say, they're both important, and we can kind of somewhat quantify one versus the other, because in some model simulations, maybe the cold tongue is more of the problem. They may have good low cloud representation. In some models, it might be the opposite or both. But yeah, you're right. I mean, I could kind of, with this sort of diagnostic, I could take these fields and kind of say, I just want this part to be biased, right? Just look at the northern. Does that answer your question, or at least touch?
Yes. But obviously, in reality, they are all coupled together. So, by the speculation. So I think, it would be interesting to just see which part of the anomaly would be, because you are putting in the entire structure of the anomaly.
It's a potential. This paper, I guess, is almost hopefully accepted, but it's something more we could have done. But I think even the reviewers were like, they wanted it to be shorter. So I was trying to make it shorter so that I could reach more people. But I think there's a lot you can do with a simple model like that. I think it's a good experiment to doing this dynamics is you do these simple experiments and you say, well, what if we make the rotation the opposite direction? We change the rotation rate. Those are the sorts of ideas that I really like. And that Levi likes. Simple. I realized.
Simple. So I know we've talked about this a little bit. We'll talk about it more tomorrow. But when I'm used, from sort of a global perspective, I'm used to the ITCZ bias kind of often being talked about in terms of the Western Pacific. And a lot of times with global studies, we'll just have a zonal mean precipitation field. And you see, you see a bump in the southern south of the equator that's identified as the bias. And that comes from a totally different part of the Pacific than what you're talking about. Have you thought about trying to run this diagnostic tool in the Western Pacific? And I would expect that the mechanisms would be very different in terms of, you know, you don't have as many stratocumulus clouds. That precipitation bias is coming from deep convection. Have you thought about trying to go in that direction and how that may change some of the results?
Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, I'm on the wrong slide here. But because you can kind of see the West Pacific.
Yeah, you see it right there. That's how I've often thought of the double ITC bias is that precip kind of to the east of Australia.
So you can actually kind of see it here. There's actually two blue.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like it extends pretty far west. Yeah,
and it's a very different, it's a very different cloud structure there.
Yeah.
Because you don't have the stratocumulus clouds.
Yeah. I don't have the SST plot. The westward extension of the cold tongue would speak to that. So I kind of feel like there could still be connections between the what the ITCZ is doing and the cold tongue.
If the cold tongue gets there. But yeah. I mean, you could run your model at every longitude.
Well, it doesn't even need to be the cold tongue as long as there's a change in the temperature field so that there's a dearth. I mean, like there's a relative minimum.
Yeah. I mean, you get an influence on the pressure gradient,
right?
Something, and you could diagnose what.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean, in theory, it could be different mechanisms. The cold tongue may not have that because it's not really a cold tongue, but if there's a bias where it's colder than it should be on the equator, which is what we see, in one of these plots here, there it is. You can see how it extends pretty far west.
Yeah.
Into your region, so I wonder.
Yeah.
If that could have an effect, but it'd be cool to run it in that region. It would make the most sense to run it there.
I think you should run it at every longitude through the whole Pacific and see what you get. It's quick, right?
So I haven't done it in the east-west direction. Like the model's not written for that, but
just change the boundary conditions and you have it.
Right? I know.
Do it for every longitude.
We should do it. Yeah.
So totally they're not coupled to each other, but that'd be fine. So we have lunch, and then the graduate students can meet afterwards. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.